Okay, hello everyone. I'm Panagiotis, or Panos for short. We'll be presenting this and that, and it's a joint work with Mario and Giles. So the task is discovering approximate functional dependencies. So given samples from some underlying domain consisting of attributes and the target, the task is to find subsets curly X, for example, X1 and X2, such that y becomes a function or an approximate function of x. One thing to note is that here we don't care for the particular form of the function. And while this is a general problem concerning both categorical and continuous variables, in this paper we only consider the categorical case. So now why is this useful? It's useful for exploratory data analysis, where we want to find features that correlate a lot with a target of interest. For example, we have genes and some disease. And it goes all the way up to finding actuating mechanism and causal relations. It's also useful for privacy-preserving data mining. We want to publish a data set and we want to hide sensitive information. And just removing this column, for example, it can be gender. It might not be enough because there is can be explained by the other variables in our data set. Another useful application is feature selection. We want to feed nice features to a learning algorithm, but it's also nice for feature evaluation, where we step one, instead of trying different algorithms to see what is the accuracy, we always get bad accuracy and so on. Oops, sorry. We basically go one step back and try to see if our features are good. So we keep asking, is this particular features good? Is there a function from these features to the target? And this particular application concerns some collaborators of ours, material scientists. Essentially, they try to explain a very complex variable, which is the energy of the solid state of binary semiconductors. And essentially, they underwent a procedure of constructing physically meaningful features and trying to see if there is a function towards that complex variable. Okay, the challenges that we are facing is we want to find an interpretable score phi that quantifies this approximation. We want to compute this phi on finite data, and we want an appropriate estimator phi hat for this. And of course, we need an effective optimization algorithm for phi hat because there is this is an exponentially large space. Of course, we will use information theory. Some background. On the left, we have Shannon entropy, which measures the information content of a variable. And on the right, we have the conditional Shannon entropy that measures the information content of a variable having observed curly X in that case. So here we have the function information. So essentially, we combine the Shannon entropy and the conditional Shannon entropy. The denominator is known as the mutual information. And as we see, this score has been it's quite known in the literature for many years. It's in 0, 1, and the extreme cases of 0 and 1 correspond to independence and functional dependency. And if the user asks, well, what does this mean? We can tell him that it measures the proportional reduction in uncertainty of y by knowing x. So now we need to find an estimator for the fraction information. But we need to consider a few things first. First thing we need to consider is that dependence measures have inflated estimates due to limited data, a behavior called dependence by chance. We also need to consider the curse of dimensionality, where data sparsity becomes exponentially worse as dimension increases. And if these two are combined, which are bound to be combined if we are searching high dimensional spaces for functions, then the results can be arbitrarily wrong. And I have a small demonstration for this. Here we have variable x and y. We generate 1,000 samples independently. And for the case of x, we consider five different dimensionalities, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So the score should always be zero because they have been generated independently. But as we see, the naive estimator, f hat, the red line, starts showing dependence basically after dimensionality 3. So how are we going to solve this problem? Well, a nice idea is to compute this overestimation and subtract it from the actual from the score that we computed. And this is very hard in the general case, but we can focus in the particular case of independence. So we have the estimator, and we will subtract the expected value of the score if we know that x and y are independent. So I will refer to that thing with B0. It's much easier. And now the next question is how we will estimate this thing from data. And we will do it with the permutation model. So what we do basically is we permute the y samples such that we break the link between x and y. And by permuting the y samples, we basically have all possible permuted data sets that we can have from x and y. And then we take the expected value over all these data sets. And now, as we see, this is very expensive if we actually do the permutations. But there is a very nice way of exploiting symmetries and so on. And we can do it exact in closed form in this complexity, which is maximum in the number of samples and categories and number of categories for x and y. And it's also very easily parallelizable. And a nice thing is that this particular quantity is a consistent estimator of the bias under independence, which combined with the consistency of the naive estimator then makes our score a consistent estimator of the fractional information. So we named our score the reliable fractional information because contrary to the naive estimator, as data become more sparse, then the reliable fraction information approaches zero instead of one. And for a small demonstration, I have the exact same experiment. And now the green line is the reliable fraction information. And as we see, it doesn't show any dependence. Okay. So now I will focus on the discovery part. So we want to find the top k subsets that maximize the F0 score, such that we allow for alternative explanations for the user. However, maximizing mutual information is NP hard. And while we don't really maximize mutual information, but we also have this B0 term, it's very unlikely that the problem becomes easier and very, very unlikely that the problem can be solved polynomial time. So that's why we will use the branch and bound framework that offers good performance, can offer good performance for hard problems. So for that, we need an admissible bounding function, F bar. So given X, for all the supersets of X, it holds that the bounding function evaluated on X is upper bounds the score on all its supersets. Have a small demonstration for that. So this is our search space. And then we have F bar, evaluated node X1, and essentially, it upper bounds the score evaluated in all of its supersets. Okay, so now the actual branch and bound algorithm, we have a branching operator that generates the search space in a non-redundant way. And then we traverse this space in some order. For example, it can be DFS or BFS. We always keep track of the current best solution. And then we prune the remaining branch if the bounding function evaluated at a node is smaller or equal than the score of the best solution. So now the bounding function for the F0 score. First, we had to establish a theorem that states that given two sets of variables, X and X prime, where X prime is a superset, it holds that the B0 is a monotonically increasing function with the subset relation. Okay. The derivation of the bounding function is very easy. We have, for all subsets of X prime, so we have X prime and all its subsets, we know that the fractional information, the naive one in general, it's upper bounded by one. We know that the B0 upper bounds all its subsets. So basically, this quantity here is smaller or equal than one minus B0 of its subsets. So then we have our bounding function F0. It's very easy and very fast to compute. And of course, the branch and bound framework has a worst case exponential complexity, but it offers a trade-off between accuracy for efficiency in a controlled manner. So if we have an accuracy parameter alpha between 0 and 1 and prune using that rule, basically we know that our solution is alpha close to the best possible solution. So if it's 1, we have the optimal solution. If it's less, we are alpha close to the best possible solution. So now we'll move on to the evaluation part. First of all, we have the bias and variance of our estimator. And for that, we sampled 100 distributions covering weak, low, high, and strong dependencies, which means basically that 25 of them have a score between 0 and 0.25. 25 of them have a score between 0.25 and 0.5, and so on. Then for each of these distributions, we generate 1,000 datasets of 5, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, and 60 samples. In that way, we simulate different data sparsity scenarios. And since we know the actual distribution, we can calculate the empirical absolute bias and standard deviation. And we compare against the naive estimator that I showed you before, and also an adjusted for chance fraction information with a framework that was proposed last year for this particular case. So here we average the absolute empirical bias across all distributions. And we see basically that we have much better bias than the other estimators. So 2 times and 3 times less bias. Especially in the case, in the very extreme scenario of having very few samples. Now we move on to the part where we have only the 25 weak dependencies, and we see again that they offer much better bias. And even in the case of strong dependencies, if you remember, we basically remove the bias under the independence, so it would be nice to see what is happening when there's strong dependence. So we see here that, again, we have much, we have better bias than the other estimators. And usually when you try to remove, to reduce the bias of an estimator, you have to trade some variance. And here in this plot, we see basically that our estimator trades very little bias for variance, as we see. Next evaluation is on the optimization performance. And for that, we search for the best solution in all 42 datasets from the KIL dataset repository that satisfies the criterion of having samples between 10, 113,000, and the number of variables is between 60 and 90. So I have the scatter plot. As you see, we have a collection of small to medium sized datasets. We used an appropriate alpha values such that the algorithm terminates in less than 30 minutes, and we see that in the majority of the cases, like 30 datasets, we were able to find the optimal solution in less than 30 minutes. For 3 of them, 0.9 and so on. And especially for the optimal solutions, 28 of them were able to finish in under 6 minutes. Now we have a better comparison to show actually how much how good is our bounding function as our search framework in general. So here I have the comparison against a more naive bounding function. And essentially we see it's speeded sorted according to speed up. And we see that there is an insane amount of speed up, especially in the last two scenarios, where it will take 20 and 145 years respectively. Now we'll move on to some exemplary discoveries that we searched for. And first I have a toy example, which is tic-tac-toe. And while deploying our method for on the tic-tac-toe example, we found that the most relevant for determining who is the winner positions is the red positions. So it's the subset of the corner and the middle position, which is a sensible finding because these are the positions that contribute to, they're in the most winning configurations, as we see on the right figure. And of course, I also have a more serious example. It's a case study on material science dataset. This dataset had 28 samples and 14 attributes, such as electronegativity. And the top dependence that we found is two atomic properties that were involved in the best model using a nonlinear subgroup discovery method and the best linear lasso model. To conclude, we consider the problem of measuring and discovering approximate functional dependencies from data. We designed the reliable estimator for F that achieves good bias for variance trade-off. We developed a search scheme that allows for the discovery of the top K optimal and alpha approximate dependencies. And for future work, we want to further investigate on the statistical properties of our estimator and extend it to continuous data. This is our website. We can find the code and the paper. And that's it. Thanks.
Any questions?